So hello everyone. Nice to see you. Well, I know that Python wasn't chosen by you and other developers to have problems with memory management, how it is adjusted, and all the memory leaks. But I think that it's good to know what is under the hood. During presentation, I will introduce possible Python implementations, but I will focus on one default implementation. And then I will present how it is organized, and including garbage collector. At the end, I will shortly introduce two most popular and free tools used for memory management. So how Python manages memory? There is no one straight answer on this question because it depends on the implementation. One basic and the default implementation is CPython. It is written in a C language, but we are not limited to only this one. C-sharp fans can use, for example, Iron Python, which is full and implementation, which covers all the main aspects and SDK. And it nicely integrates with .NET platform. The other possible solution may be JPython. It is dedicated for a Java language. It has this one pleasant advantage that Python code can be called directly from Java. And also Python can allow us to call Java code by using some prepared modules. Other implementation is RPython. It's a subset of Python with one slightly difference that it is statically typed. Its advantage is possibility to precompile a code that we will be using, so it makes Python libraries and tools run much faster than the default implementation. And the last one that I have here is PyPy. This is, on the other hand, built on RPython. So it has all the advantages of RPython, but in contrast to RPython, it allows full coverage of Python library. Well, every process in Python gets a private heap, which is managed by interpreter. And the user don't have influence on it. So all the dynamic allocation takes place on the heap itself. At the beginning of every process, there is available strictly defined heap volume, which can be shrinked or it can grow. Well, to avoid any problems that we can have with Python with memory in Python during our program works is to avoid using any direct allocations of memory from a C language. So if you, for example, write some extension to Python, it's best to use some dedicated methods that can be found in a Python library. If we look at the memory model in layers, the plus three layers is the top abstraction that we can have in Python code. So if all our calls to Python from Python language, like allocation of dictionaries, lists, integer, and so on, happens there. Layer plus two is the layer where the topmost layer calls Python allocators. For example, there is a difference how we allocate memory for our custom classes and for strings and on integers. And every difference happens in this layer. And in this layer also works a garbage collector. And not only this, the garbage collector that collects unused memory that, for example, is released when we are going out of scope, but also cyclic garbage collector. Layer plus one, it allows allocation. It directly speaks with OS memory management system, like all the methods that we can see here, like malloc, calloc, are wrapped here. Well, the other layers are not as interesting from the Python point of view, so I will omit them. Well, there is also another set of memory. It's not related with a private key, but it is a stack. And the stack maybe could be more familiar for those one who have already experience in low-level languages like C or C++. So as it was on the previous slide, the memory can be allocated on heap or stack. Stack is a continuous block of temporal memory, and it's dedicated for local variables in the methods. And heap is a various non-organized hierarchical allocator during a runtime. So how it can be dealt with Python? Well, it depends on the place of implementation. If we consider the code here below, we can see two set of objects. There is a global and local ones inside a function. According to documentation, global variables are allocated on a private heap, and they are available in a whole program. In case of methods, it's a little bit different, because local variables, and they are called references, they are allocated on a stack. But the object itself, the reference is addressing to, is allocated on heap. Well, how it looks in overall. Private heap is divided to set of different mapped block objects in the memory in defined sizes. The biggest block that we can achieve by using standard allocator is 256 kilobyte, and it is called arena. Arenas are interlinked each other as a two-directional list. And within arenas, we can find pools. And these pools are split into blocks. Yeah, blocks are the smallest elements of memory that can be allocated. Their size can oscillate from 8 to 512 bytes, and it can be assigned to one of the classes. Which is important from the pool management point of view. The size of the block isn't equal to the amount of memory we would like to allocate. So for example, if we allocate 45 bytes, we get a bigger block, 48 bytes. And the block can be occupied only by one object. There is no sharing of blocks. And if we have a bigger object, it can be allocated on a multiple blocks. But what to do if we, for example, need to allocate a bigger object? Well, in case of big allocations that are higher than 512 bytes, in this case, the Python uses raw allocation, so it uses different set of methods. But also, the memory that we allocate will be managed by the same manager. Well, everything in Python is an object, which base class, or rather structure, because it's C language, looks like this. It contains a pointer to the object type that we are allocating. So it's the object itself. It's an address of memory. And what is very important, it contains a reference counter. And also a header that is listed also here. And this header is a room for a more complex object like list, because it contains two pointers for next and a previous object in the collection. Let's consider this small, simple example. When we create an empty list, this is the initial allocation. When we add new element into our list, the list size extends, but not always. It's because the Python tries to predict what we would like to achieve, and the list can grow. So it usually pre-allocates some bigger block of memory. And if we add new elements and it fits to the memory previously allocated, it won't be extended. Sometimes when we add new elements and the size grows, there could appear some problems because there could be no room, for example, for such extension. And the Python in this case will need to reallocate the whole list, and it couldn't be done in place, so it have to find a place in arenas or in pools to find a consistent block of memory, so it can influence on the performance of the program, because it will be the whole process will have to take place in the moment we would like to call this method. Mentioned blocks are part of pools, and every pool has a size of 4 kilobytes. Pools are linked the same way arenas are, so as to directional list. And what's interesting, pools can have some strict features. Every pool can contain only blocks of the same size. So for example, if we have a pool containing a block of 16 bytes, and you would like to allocate another object which is bigger, the interpreter will have to find or create another pool for such object. Pool can be in three states. It can be in use when at least one block is occupied and at least one block is free. It can be full when all blocks are taken, and free when it's totally free. It's totally free, and there is no size assigned to this block. As I told before, pools are part of the arenas, and arenas are also interlinked. And they are managed from this structure point of view. It contains the max arenas max arenas variable, which contains all the number of allocated objects. Sorry, I had to check something. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, that's fine. Because I have small problems on my laptop, but it's good. You have everything here. Okay, so it contains also unused arena objects. This is a single linked list of arena objects that are currently not being used in associated with them. And what is interesting, what is the initial memory size that is pre-allocated on the heap? Well, it's a 4 megabytes because initially there are 16 arenas allocated, and if every arena has 4 megabytes, it can give 4 megabytes in total. Did my slide just move forward, or did I stay on the same?
Forward.
Okay. As I previously described, every object has some very crucial feature from a Python point of view. And it is a reference counter. It is increased every time we initialize our variable. And every time we assigned a new variable to existing object, the reference counter increases. And from the other hand, it's decreases every time we are going out of scope, or the variable is removed by using delete keyword. So when we call delete, we in fact don't delete object. We only decrease the reference counter, and inform when the reference counter reaches zero, it is information for an interpreter to release such block memory. But it's not deleted from the memory itself. It just releases a block to the pool, so it can be reused next time it will be expected. The real memory releasing happens on the arena level when all the pools are empty. So for example, in this case, we create a lamp object, and next we assigned a second reference addressing the same object, and in this case the reference counter reaches 2. When we remove the lamp object, we decrease the reference counter, but the memory won't be released because we previously assigned another lamp reference to this object. And for example, to monitor how many memory is used and how big is reference counter for every object, we can use one of the methods I proposed here, a get ref count. Next, what sometimes happens to our code is our oversights. For example, we can create cyclic references. Let's take a look at this next example. We have two classes that points each other. And in this example, if we remove class B object, it will decrease the reference counter, but it won't be decreased to zero. And garbage collector won't be started. In this case, Python isn't helpless because in the background there is a mechanism called a cyclic garbage collector, which starts periodically, and it monitors state of the objects. Objects that are monitored this way are divided into three generations. At the beginning, when object is created, it belongs to the first category. When the object isn't removed during the first check of the cyclic garbage collector, it is moved to second generation, and next the third, when it stays till the end. So this is the very smart mechanism for detecting such features. It just checks if there is some kind of orphaned object, and if it is orphaned, it will be removed in such occasion. What is the drawback? That when we have, for example, a lot of objects and the garbage collector is run, it stops everything because it needs to be done in the same thread as we are working on. So cyclic garbage collector just uses generational garbage collection algorithm to track, detect, and deallocate cyclic reference object. Scanning objects is time-consuming, because algorithm runs periodically. When it runs, everything else is stopped, as I mentioned. Algorithm can be tweaked from the GC module. We can specify threshold. For example, we can increase the number of objects we would like to trigger our garbage collection. And garbage collection status can be monitored or even could be invoked intentionally by a GC collect. Well, there are many tools that can be used for such purpose. For example, we can use Trace Malloc. It is built in into standard library. It just traces memory blocks allocated by Python. And it can provide following information. Trace back where an object was allocated. It can give us some statistics on allocated memory blocks. We can have printed file name, line number, total size, and average size of allocated memory blocks if the objects were allocated, for example, in a loop. It just uses some summation to give us overall number. The second tool, that it is external tool, but it's free to use, is a memory profiler. It gives some detailed output line by line about memory allocation. It's integrated with a graphical components for visual representation. And this is the end of this main part of my presentation. I can show you some simple examples that I prepared. Okay, so first, it is Trace Malloc, which is very simple to use. I will show you only the simplest functionality. To use it, it needs to be Trace Malloc module needs to be imported and started by a start method. It's not a complicated call. Starting this method tweaks memory allocators because it adds some hooks into all the allocations that will be performed in our code. And next on our wheel, it will do memory snapshots, which will be dumped onto console. But there is a possibility to archive the result in a file. Default functionality dumps everything what process allocated, and maybe it's not necessary what we are searching for. I can just show you what I'm talking about. I will just uncomment this line. Yes, as you can see in this example, when I call this method, not only something that I have in my file was dumped in the Trace Malloc, but also, for example, something from nPath module. I don't want to see this anymore. I will show you soon what to do to avoid this. Here we have, for example, size is the size of memory that is allocated. Count is the count of blocks that were used to build such allocation. And average is the average block size that was used for this allocation. So for example, to limit the number of object we would like to track in our memory dump is to provide a filter. And this filter can take as an argument file name, which can be a pattern that we will apply. Inclusive is information to only present in the output the exact module. It's not the only possibility of this trace malloc tool. For example, we can track the differences between snapshots, because the default snapshot just gives us overall amount of memory that is currently allocated. And what if we would like to check the difference, there is a comparator. So every snapshot object has a compare to method when we can specify another snapshot taken previously, and it will give us a memory difference between those calls. I can show you again. So as you can see now, it shows us also the size of currently allocated memory, including a line when it was performed, but also the difference. Here we have plus 3000, 5 and 10. And in line 10 also have some allocator, yes? And it also shows us how many blocks more were allocated. On the next example, I will show you the memory leak problem. When we have this small example containing two classes A and B, and in the loop, in the memleak method, I will iterate in a range of 10,000 and do a cross referencing between A and B objects. And to show you that the problem exists with non-collected memory, there is a module called GC, and the module GC can print us the total number of objects that are not collected and are still exist in memory. And as I told you before, there are three generations, 1, 2, and 3. And the allocation here done in memleak allocated a lot of objects that weren't released. We can see it here. Yes. I increased here because we can manipulate the threshold that can be used to inform the cyclic garbage collector about releasing the memory. And for example, if this threshold will be low, you can see a different value of this threshold, because the garbage collector can happen without our will in the background. The second tool that I would like to present you shortly is a memory profiler. To use it, we will have to grab it from the packaged processor PIP. We can use PIP to collect such modules, and it can give us a possibility to also to dump the memory status onto console, but it also have a possibility to present the result in a graphical way, the same way the Matplotlib presents its results. If we would like to dump some memory information onto our console, I just need a wrapper called profile. It can be tweaked by precision parameter, which informs how deeply the memory analyzer should look at our results, and it gives us 4 decimal points information about allocation. And it also, maybe it's a little bit more robust. It gives us not a plain list of allocators, but it presents its better looking way. We can look at every method one by one, and one by one the methods that the lines that happens under our method. Let me show you how to, if you would like to, for example, present the result in the graphical way, we will have to tweak it a little bit. We'll have to remove this declarator. We have to remove the importer, because this is how it works. And then we will have to run this profiler by calling this method, pointing the file that we would like to track. Oh, sorry, I have wrong arguments here. Okay, now it's finished. So to plot it, I just call mprof. I'm not sure if you can see it. I can do another share, maybe whole screen. So this is, it shows in the time domain how the memory was allocated, what moments, and what exact calls caused such jump in the memory allocation. So thank you. This is all from me.
Thank you, Tomek. Maybe have some question. Yeah, we have some comment in chat. Could you please check it?
Okay. Yes, the first question is, does it have sense to run gc-collect after calling del-sum object? Well, gc-collect isn't expected when we have a good code and we don't have cyclic references in collect objects, because it only runs the cyclic garbage collector process, which will clear orphaned objects. The next question, could I somehow or other force unload module? Well, as I know, if we import a module, it is imported into our process. So our process and the interpreter related to this process will take care of everything. So if there is a cyclic reference in there, calling GC collect, I think will clear all the memory. Of course, if there, if everything in this mod, in this module was designed in a suggested way, without calling pure C methods for allocations, if we were using, if the created module uses Python suggested allocators, everything should be fine.
Maybe one more question. No. Looks okay. Like, yeah, looks like no. Yeah, yeah, we have one more.
One more. Could you provide an example in practice where it would be advisable to change the threshold? Well, if we have a good code and we don't expect having cyclic references, I think it would be needed. But for example, if we predict that some code has some problems because there are cyclic references, we can monitor it via memory profiler, and we can see that the memory grows. And we expect, for example, that it grows in some certain limit, and we wouldn't like to pause the our process, and for example, postpone the garbage collection to the moment we would like to have. Maybe it's a good moment to increase the threshold. So the whole loop, for example, or the call to the external method will be finished, and then it will be collected. So this is how I see it.
Yeah, guys, you can unmute and ask question, not just write, if you have. No, looks like no. Okay. Yeah, Tomek, I'd like to tell thank you for your performance, and thanks all who join us today. And we will happy to see all of you next event. Thank you and have a nice day.
Thank you too. Have a good weekend.
Bye. Bye.